Morning. We are in Sefer Yeshayahu. We're going to take a look at another pasuk in Perek Yud Beis. We learned last week pasuk Aleph. Amarta b'yom ahu od Hashem kionafta b'yosher apcha usanachemeni. It's talking about the days of Mashiach. And as we mentioned last week, Od Hashem Kenafta Bi Yoshua Pros Nachameini has to a certain extent the same lesson we have in it every Erev Shabbos going into Shabbos. The next world is called the Yom Shekuloi Toiv, the world that's completely good, or have no evil in it. And Shabbos, we say, is Me'ein Olam Haba. We have the famous song, obviously, Me'ein Olam Haba. But the Gemara calls it a Me'ein of Olam Haba. Shabbos is a Me'ein Olam Haba. And in that sense, what we go through on Erev Shabbos, we mentioned last week, right before Hashem said, Vayechu HaShemayim V'Oretz, it says, Vayar Elokim Es Kol Asher Osa V'Nei Tov Ma'od, Vayer Vayvoka Yom HaShishi. The Yom HaShishi concluded with Tov Ma'od. And this is after the Chet of Adam HaRishon. The Rebbeinu Shlomo says Tov Ma'od. And with that, the person goes into Shabbos and is Makade Shabbos. We read the Pachad Yitzchok last week. Rav Futner explains that the person needs to go into Shabbos without any tainus on the Hanhog, without any tainus that the Rebbeinu Shlomo Chas Shalom is unfair, that he's not conducting the world properly, Chas V'Shalom. We go in, and we, after the 6 days of ups and downs, we come back and we say, in our own way, we say that the world is a Toiv Ma'od. Now we're ready to go into Shabbos. And by the same token, by Yom Ha'hu, on that great day, Od Hashem Kenafta B'Yoshev Apos Nachameini, will be able to praise Hashem for all the times that we thought God was angry with us, and in fact he was making us grow and blossom, as we spoke about. We learned the Shem Mishmul in Parshas Ba'aloscha. So now we go to the second pasuk. Hine Kel Yeshua Siyavdach. We're very familiar with this pasuk. Yeshaya Perek Yud Beis, Pasuk Beis, page 104 in the Art Scroll. Hine Kel Yeshua Siyavdach. I put my confidence, my trust in the Rebbeinu Shalom. Velo Efchad, and therefore I fear nothing. Ki Ozi Vezimros Ka, because my strength and my praise, or my strength and my ability to cut down my enemies. The word zemer can have two meanings. Zemer can mean a song, and zemer can also mean to cut something down. In Parshas Bahar, in the Parsha of Shemitah, it says, Kamacha lo sizmor, don't cut your vines. So sizmor also means, zemer means to cut down. So there are two explanations to the word vizimras in this pasuk. Yazi vizimras ka Hashem. Hashem is my strength and my praise. Or Hashem is my strength, and through that strength I can cut down my enemies. Vayihi Yeshua, and he is a salvation for me. I'm just noting, we're not going to deal with it today. Just note that in Pasuk Beis, Hine Kel Yeshua Siyavdach V'lo Yafchad, Ki Ozi V'Zimros Ka. First we have Hashem's name with the Ka, Yud Hey, without the ending Vav Hey, and then we have the Yud K Vav K, Ki Ozi V'Zimros Ka Hashem. For those who are interested, you can take a look at the bottom of page 104 in your Art Scroll commentary, and it discusses the Ka followed by the Yud Ke Vav Ke. What I'd like to focus on today a bit is Pasuk Gimel. We know that the Pasuk Beis Hinei Kel Yeshuasi begins our Havdalah Moitzoi Shabbos. Pasuk Gimel Ushafta Mayim B'Sasa Mimayne HaYeshua. and you will draw water with joy from the springs of salvation. And of course, that's also a pasuk in our weekly Havdalah. So we talked about last week the first pasuk Varmarta Bayomahu Ot Hashem Kenafta Biyoshev Achus Nachameni as sort of something we can take with us to help us understand excuse me, how we prepare to go into Shabbos Kodesh. We go in by looking at the past week and its ups and downs as Tov Ma'od. And we enter Shabbos in a mode of Tov Ma'od. We enter Shabbos with a Neshama Yaseva, the extra Neshama we spoke about last week. Rashi in Masech Debeit after Zion says a Neshama Yaseva is the ability we get to eat more. And that's what Rashi says in after Zion, and we're able to eat more on Shabbos, which means that Shabbos is a day where we can take that which we do during the week, physical, and elevate it to be spiritual. So we have wonderful, good, tasty foods on Shabbos, because that's part of the idea of Neshama Yaseva, Rashi tells us. And after we come to this high on Shabbos, where we get the ability to elevate the physical world into a more spiritual world, the Shabbos, that's Me'ein Olam Haba, it's a microcosm of the world to come. We come and we make Havdalah, and we're preparing to go into the next week, which is going to be a week of ups and downs. And again, we're going to go to the following Shabbos and say Tov Ma'od. So how does Havdalah meaning separate, how does separate us, the Havdalah, how does separating from Shabbos prepare us for the week that's going to come? As I mentioned several times, the Baal Shem Tov is noted having said that if he were the one that was making the takana about Kiddush and Havdalah, the Anshei Knesset HaGdolah, the men of the Great Assembly, who lived at the end of the first Beis HaMikdash and just the very beginning of the second Beis HaMikdash, and we know from our Pirkei Avos studies this time of year, in the first Perek, it says, Shimon HaTzadik Hoye Mishori Anshei Knesset HaGdolah, Shimon HaTzadik, who was a Kohen Gadol, he was the last member of the Great Assembly of 120 men. That Great Assembly organized the Shemona Esrei. It organized Kiddush. It organized Havdalah. It organized the brachas we make. And so they decided that Friday you make Kiddush, and Moitzoy Shabbos you make Havdalah. The Baal Shem Tov would say that he would have made Havdalah on Friday. In other words, I've gone through this mundane six-day week, ups and downs, and I'd like to separate myself from that week and now begin the process of Shabbos and be able to elevate myself. And then by the time 24, 25 hours later, I feel elevated, more spiritual, more holy, and now I want to make Kiddush. But the Baal Shem Tov said that Chazal appropriately set up Kiddush on Friday and set up Havdalah Moitzoy Shabbos. How does Havdalah, separating from the Shabbos, prepare you for the week that's going to come? So several weeks ago, when we were talking about Parshas Tazria in the Parshas year, I mentioned the Rav Kook about the Seder Havdalah. And in particular, we spoke about the Rav Kook. He asks a question. We make a bracha on fire, Moitzoy Shabbos. We say, Baruch atah Hashem Elokeinu Melech Olam, Borei Mi'orei Ha'esh, you created the fire. And yet the Gemara tells us, Chazal tell us, that it was on a Saturday night, that the first Saturday night in the history of the world. We'll leave it at that question about when the world was created, the first day of creation. But for us, the first Moitzoy Shabbos that we can limit that phrase by saying the first Moitzoy Shabbos of Adam HaRishon's life. That first Moitzoy Shabbos, he rubbed two rocks together and fire came out. And we commemorate that Moitzoy Shabbos. One of the reasons we make a bracha on fire is to commemorate Adam HaRishon's creation, Adam HaRishon inventing fire, Motzoi Shabbos. So Rav Kook asks, if we understand, no, that other Mauritian invented fire Motzoi Shabbos, so it's his invention, why then Motzoi Shabbos do we say, Baruch atah Hashem Elokeinu Melech Haolam, Borei Meori Ha'esh, blessed are you God who created the fire, man created the fire, other Mauritian created the fire. And Rav Kook explains that this is an introduction, this helps set up the week that's about to come. As we go into the new week, we're separating out from Shabbos. We rested on Shabbos, because as God created the world in 6 days and rested on Shabbos, we emulate that. We work our 6 days and we rest on Shabbos. So we're emulating the Ribono Shel Olam. And now Motzoi Shabbos, we are preparing for the next week. And in order to prepare for the next week, we need to understand that everything that we do in the next week, our inventions, our great strategies that we come up with at work or in our homes, the great ideas, the great plans, these are also God's work. Man is not living in a vacuum where there's an area where God has no, God is not acting in there. Everything that that man does is with the Ribono Shel Olam. And while man has his ishtadlus, his efforts, nothing will happen to those efforts unless the Ribono Shel Olam puts a bracha on those efforts. So Motzoi Shabbos, when Chazal tell us that other Mauritian rubbed two rocks together and fire came out, we make a special bracha. Yes, other Mauritian rubbed the rocks together, fire came out. Oh, it's other Mauritian's invention. We say, Baruch atah Hashem Elokeinu Melech Haolam, Borei Meori Ha'esh. God created Adam, God created Adam's mind, he created ideas, and yes, Adam Mauritian rubbed the two rocks together, that's his effort, but at the end, it's a creation of God, and that's how we enter our work week after Shabbos. I'm about to, making Havdalah from Shabbos. I've just celebrated the fact that God created the world in 6 days. God created the world in 6 days and rested on the seventh, and I'm emulating that. And now I'm moving to the next week with the understanding that God created the world. That's the lesson I learned from Shabbos. God created in six and rested on seventh, and I emulate that. Now I'm moving to the next week with that lesson embedded in my mind, God created the world. And now I say, Borei Meori Ha'esh, although Adam Rishon invented the fire, it is God's work by blessing Adam Rishon's efforts in rubbing the two rocks together. And that's the process that we begin with Havdalah. We want to start a new week. We want to start it on the right foot, so to speak. We want to start it with the conscious idea that what we accomplish during the week is our effort blessed by God. What happens to the week is something that is in the hands of the Ribono Shel Olam, in the words of the Ramchal and the Dastmon, is the Echad Yochad Amiyuchad, the part of the Gilei Ayichud. I'm entering this week, and everything is going to be under God's control, and God's watching the world, and there's no chaos. And so that's how we begin the new week. In that sense, let's take a now look at that third pasuk. U'shafta maya b'sason mimayne ha'yeshua. You will draw water with joy from the springs of salvation. It is this pasuk that the Gemara in Sukkah quotes with respect to nisuch hamayim and sukkahs. We know that during the year, when certain karbonos were brought, Korban Tumah in the morning, Korban Tumah in the afternoon, other kinds of karbonos. When certain karbonos were brought, wine was poured on the Mizbeach, and we learned about the Shitin, the special pipe that went down to the center of the earth when the wine was poured on the Mizbeach, according to one Shita. And then on Sukkot, they poured water on the Mizbeach as well. And there was a process known as Simchas Beis HaShoeva, the Simcha of the drawing of the water. Shoeva, and that pasuk is right here in front of us. Yeshaya Perek Yud Beis, pasuk Gimel. Ushaftem Mayim Besasa. You will draw water. Ushaftem. Simchas Beis HaShoeva. The Gemara in Sukkah, the Gemara says that Nisa Chamayim, the Gemara in Sukkah Nachmem Ches, the Mishnah says Nisa Chamayim, it goes through the process by which the water was drawn and being poured on the Mizbeach. If you remember from our Masecht Midos, our famous diagram number 3, Simchas Beis HaShareva took place in the Ezra's Noshim. The Levium stood on the 15 steps of Nicanor, right before the Nicanor entrance. They stood on these 15 steps. It was on these 15 steps that the Levium stood and sang the 15 Shir Hamalos. We learned in from Masech the Sukkah why David composed 15 Shir Hamalos, which have to do with water and building the Mizbeah. At any rate, there are 15 steps. Levium are standing on the 15 steps. And they're singing the 15 Shir Hamalos. The Simchas Beis HaShareva is occurring in the Ezra's Noshim with the men here. And a balcony was built on the walls of the Ezra's Noshim where the women were able to stand and view the Simchas Beis HaShareva. But the Mishnah on Daf Mem Ches in Sukkah says, this is not on your handout, the Mishnah says, Nisa Chamayim Ketzad, how did the pouring of the water occur on the Mizbeach? There was a big pitcher of gold that held a certain measurement, 3 lugin of water. He would fill this water, this pitcher would be filled with water from the Shiloah. I think there are signs outside the old city. It says Siloah or Siloan, whatever it says there. It's the Shiloah. Higiu l'shar hamayim, toku v'hiriu v'toku. They got to the shar hamayim. We go back to our beloved diagram 3. And on the southern wall of the Azara, there's a gate called shar hamayim. And they came with the bucket or the pitcher full of water towards the Shar Hamayim, and they came through the Shar Hamayim. Toku vehiriu v'toku. They blew a tekiah, they blew a teruah, and they blew a tekiah. And the Mishnah then continues. We won't go into the rest of the Mishnah. Toku vehiriu v'toku. They blew a tekiah, a teruah, and a tekiah when the water came to the Shar Hamayim. The Gemara in Sukkah Daf Mem Ches Amud Beis asks, Menohani Mili, how do I know, and Rashi says, how do I know that when the water got to the Shar Hamayim, that you blow shofar? Taku ve'riu v'taku. And the Gemara answers, Amrav Eina de Omakra Ush'avtem Mayim Besosad. It comes from our Pasuk in Yeshaya, Perek Yud Beis, Pasuk Gimel, Ush'avtem Mayim besasa. And that's how we know you blow a tekiah and a trua when you bring the water, tekiah, trua, tekiah, when you bring the water for the simple space hashaway. The question is obvious for those who remember tekiah, trua, tekiah on Rosh Hashanah. And let me read the Rashi again so we can better understand the question. Rashi says in Sukkah, Daf Mem Ches Amud Aleph, Toku Veheiriu V'Toku. Rashi says, Mishum Simcha. You've blown a tekiah, a teruah, and a tekiah. Out of, because it's Simcha, it's a time of Simcha. We're bringing the water into the Beis HaMikdash. We're going to pour it on the Mizbeach. And this water is symbolic of the water that's going to come for the rest of the year. Right? Sukkot is the time that God judges the world for Mayim. And that's why we begin Mashiach V'Ruach U'Moed HaGeshem on Shmini Atzeres. It's a time of water. The seasons are changing, the rain seasons are going to come, and we We're requesting that the Ribbono Shel Olam give us a year of blessed water. So we do Disa Hamayim on the Mizbeach. And out of that Simcha, Rashi says, Taku Ve'yu Mishum Simcha. Because of Simcha. Shenemar Rashi, the Siv Rashi says, Ushafta Mayim Besasim. Rashi says, explains that the Pasuk in Yeshayah says, the drawing of the water for the Mizbeach, for Nisa Hamayim and Sukkah, should be Besasim. Well, how do you create Sasim? You can blow a Tekiah, Trua, and a Tekiah. Well, for those of us who remember Rosh Hashanah, Haba Aleinu L'Toiva, Tekiah, Trua, Tekiah, one of the reasons is not to generate Simcha. Tekiah, Trua, Tekiah is normally to generate fear, or we're getting ready for Tshuva. Which, as the Rambam uses his famous lashon in Hilchos Tshuva, Uru Yishena Mishinasem, the blasts of the shofar are meant to tell people, wake up, you've been asleep for a year. Wake up, there's not much time for you to do tshuva. Wake up, it's like an alarm clock. The alarm is not a comforting noise. If it was a comforting noise, you wouldn't wake up to it. And sometimes it gets comforting. We get used to it. We need to buy a new alarm clock. The shofar is meant to create a certain extent, a discomfort, an awe. I have to do something, a wake-up call. Yet, this pasuk teaches us, Ush'aftem mayim b'sasai, when you draw the water for the simchas beis hashem eva, you are to draw it with a joy. And therefore, since the water has to be drawn with a joy, you blow a tekiah, true a tekiah. Now, as we're talking here about Sukkos and the simchas beis hashem eva and the pouring of the water, I don't want you to lose sight of the fact that the general connotation of this perek is about the coming of Mashiach by Yom Hahu. In this coming of Mashiach perek, we have the pasuk of Ushafta Mayim Besasom, from which Chazal learned out that on Sukkos, when you pour the water on the Mizbeach, the Nisuch HaMayim, you are to do it with a Sasom, and therefore Tekiah Trua Tekiah. So while the pasuk is talking about Ushafta Mayim Besasom, you will draw water with great joy, from the well of salvation, which is talking about the time of Mashiach, it also has a meaning for the Beis HaMikdash and Sukkos. Okay, I don't want you to lose sense of that. The basic understanding of the Pasuk is about drawing water of salvation when Mashiach comes, and Chazal learned the Pasuk means drawing water with joy when the Beis HaMikdash stood and pouring it on the Mizbeach to the sound of a Tekiah, Trua, and Tekiah. Let's take a look now to understand what this Ushafta Mayim B'Sasso means in terms of the Nisuch HaMayim, and in terms of man himself, and in terms of how that helps man move from Shabbos into his work week. We once read this Pachad Yitzchak, I believe that it was distributed. It's a Pachad Yitzchak from Rosh Hashanah. And it's Maimi Yud Gimel. We learned part of this Pachad Yitzchak in the women's Bereisha Shir. We're going to take a look at it for the purpose, we're not going to learn the whole Pachad Yitzchak, we're going to look at the part that is relevant to this particular Pasuk, Hushach Emayim, Besasson, and Nisach Emayim. Going back to the Gemara in the Mishnah, the Gemara in Sukkah, around the 15 steps outside Shaar Nikanor, they're singing the Shir Hamalos, the men are dancing in the Esros Nashim, the women are on the balcony. The Gemara says in Sukkot Daf Mem Gimel that Chasidim, it's part of the Mishnah, Chasidim and Anshei Maisa, we're not talking about today's Chasidim or the Hasidic movement of the Baal Shem Tov. We're talking about in the time of the Mishnah, the time of the Beis HaMikdash, those who were very, very righteous men. Hasidim va'anshei ma'isa hayim rakdim b'fneim va'avukar sh'or sh'b'yideim. These righteous men would be dancing in the Ezra's Noshim, and they would have torches, and some of them would be, they would actually be dancing with the torches, throwing the torches in the air, catching the torches. It was a very festive time. They would be juggling torches. The Gemara says, Chassid Nevan Shemaisa, Megill and Sukkadaf Mun Gimel, Tana Rabbanon, Yesh Mehem Omer Asher Yald Nuseinu Shloi Baisha Ezig Nuseinu. There was a song they sang. There were certain people, the righteous, those who were righteous from birth, so to speak, they would sing a song that said, Ashrei Yalduseinu Shloi Baisha Ezik Nuseinu. How fortunate we are that our younger years, we didn't do anything in our younger years that can cause us shame in our older years. Eilu Chassid Nevan Shemais. Ve'esh mehem omrim Ashrei Zik Nuseinu Shekofra Ez Yalduseinu. Eilu Balei Tshuva. And then the Balei Tshuva would sing their own song, and it basically said, we are so fortunate that in our older years, we rectified and repaired that which we did in our younger years. And so we have two songs. There are those that are singing, we are so fortunate that there's nothing that we did in our younger years that can possibly shame us in our older years. And there are Balei Tshuva that are singing, fortunate that we are, that our older years have forgiven and atoned for our younger years. And then the two of them would join together, both groups, Eilu ve'Eilu Omrim, the two groups would together sing, Ashrei Misha lo chata, fortunate is the person who never sinned, u'misha chata, and someone that Chas v'Sholom did sin, Yoshu v'Yimchalo, he can come and do tshuva. And this is what they were singing at the Simchas Beis HaShoeva. The Hasidim and Anshei Ma'isa were singing, how fortunate we are that there is nothing in our younger years to shame our older years. The Balei Tshuva would sing, how fortunate we are that in our older years have atoned and brought us a kapara for our younger years. And the two of them would join together and say, Ashrei, how fortunate we are, those who didn't sin and those who did sin should now come and do tshuva. This is a song for Simchas Beis HaShoeva. So Simchas Beis HaShoeva has now turned into a great celebration of tshuva. Yeah. And that's why this forum talk about Sukkot is part and parcel of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. Sukkot has two dimensions to it. Sukkot is part of the Shalosh Regalim, Pesach, Shavuot, Sukkot. Sukkot closes the year of Shalosh Regalim. It's one of the three regalim, Pesach, Shavuot, Sukkot. But Sukkot also has another dimension to it. It is the closing of the Yomim Noraim, Rosh Hashanah, Aseres Yemei Tshuva, Yom Kippur, Sukkot. Sukkot is part and parcel of the process of atonement and the process of tshuva, of Elo, Rosh Hashanah, Aseres Yemei Tshuva, Yom Kippur. And we see that from the Simchas Beis HaShoeva. The joy, the celebration of the Simchas Beis HaShoeva, the Simcha of the drawing of the water, the Simchas Beis HaShoeva, the Simcha of the drawing of the water, revolved around this song that is a tshuva song. And so there's now a connection between the Simchas Beis HaShoeva, the drawing of the water, which must be done with joy, ushafte mayim besaso, draw the water in joy, pour it on the mizbeach, blow a blow a tekiya trua tekiya out of joy. And again, we have tekiya trua tekiya, and Rosh Hashanah reminds us to do tshuva. We're now blowing a tekiya trua tekiya in the process of bringing the water to the Beis HaMikdash, so it's again a tshuva concept as we prepare to pour the water on the mizbeach. And then when we pour the water on the mizbeach, there's singing going on, a song of tshuva. So this whole Nisach HaMayim is enveloped in a concept of tshuva. bringing it in with a tekiah tshuva tekiah, dancing the song of tshuva, and so Sukkos becomes an integral part of the tshuva process. And that's what Futna is going to discuss. We'll take a look at it briefly so that we can understand a little more about this concept in our Pasuk, Ush'afta Mayim B'Sasayim Mimayinei HaYeshua. Now, Futna explains, I'll say part of it outside, but Futna explains that on the second day, this is where we were learning this in the woman's Bereishis Shiur, on the second day of creation, God said, Yehi Rakia B'Soch HaMayim, let there be a firmament, a separation between the water above and the water below. Before the second day, the universe was what we would call a glob of water. And the Rabbeinu Shalom said, Yehi Rakia B'Soch HaMayim, let there be a firmament between, in the middle, B'Soch HaMayim. And therefore, the water, there is now something called the waters of above and the waters of below, and between the water above and the water below, there's now open space. There's water above, and there's water below, and Rashi tells us in Bereishis from Chazal that there's a firmament between the water above and the water below. So the water below is simple. The water below is being supported by earth. Then you have space, and you have a firmament. Above that, you have space again, and up here, you have water again. Well, what's holding that water up? Nothing. Rashi says that the water above is being held up by a miracle. So the universe now looks like, on day two, water elyonim, water above, separation, empty, firmament, empty, the water below, which eventually will have land around it. So the Rabbeinu Shalom on day two separated the world above, quote unquote, the Elyonim from the Tachtonim, from the world below. And this begins the process. This is the first stage in the process of creating man. Although man is going to be created on the sixth day, as we speak so in depth about this in the Das Tevuna Shir, about Bechira, free choice. Free choice means that man has two parts to him. He has his neshama that comes from above and asks and tells him and drives his life in one direction. And he has his body that comes from below, the dust of the earth, Ofer Min Adama. And that part of his life drives him to do other things. And so a person has a neshama, and that's the ingredients. Vayikach Hashem Elokim Ofer, Vayitzar Hashem Elokim Esa Odom Ofer Min Adama, Vayipach Papa Nishmas Chayim, Vayiyah Avanu Nefesh Chayim. That's the Pasuk in Bereishis. God took the dust of the earth, formed man, the physical body of the dust of the earth, and in man's nostrils, he put a breath of what we call neshama. And that neshama now made man a living being. So man has earth, dust of the earth, that is his physical component. He has a neshama, that's his ruchnius component. And these two things make up man. And it's at his most basic ingredients, most basic component parts. Therefore, man is being schlepped in two directions. His body schleps in one place. His neshama schleps in another place. And this is the internal conflict that man has to resolve during his process of perfecting himself and making himself a sholem and making the right choices through Bechira. Do I follow my neshama? Do I follow my guf, etc.? And how can I bring peace between the two of them? This idea that there will be a world above that will represent ruchnius, there will be a world below that will represent the gashmius, takes on its form on the second creation where God says, Yehi Rakia B'Soch HaMayim, let there be a firmament in the middle of the water. And he splits off the top of the universe from below. And now there's the above and there's below. There's Elyonim, there's Tachtonim. And now because there's the Elyonim and Tachtonim above and below, man is then on the sixth day formed from the above and below. And through that he has Bechira. So the idea of Bechira lies in the Hirakia Basel Hamayim of the second day. That's Rav Futner's introductory comment. Now we go back again to the water, the second day. God separated the water. When God separated the water above and from below, and below from above, Chazal tell us, and Rashi quotes this in Parshas Vayikra, that the water that ends up below, remember it's a glob of water, and it's all, for lack of a better expression right now, it's all in front of the Kisei HaKavod, God's throne. Then God says there shall be waters above and waters below with space in between, which now means in terms of physical distance. And again, when we talk about God, there's no real thing as physical distance from God because there's nothing physical. But in terms of our world, the human world in which we live, the water below is now further away than the water above. The water separated, the water above seems to be closer to God than the water below that's now closer to man. And the Medrash tells us, Rashi quotes it in Parshas Vayikra, that the waters below cried. And the waters below cried means, if you'd like to, you can take a look at Chulin, Dav Zayin, Amud Aleph. There's a Tosfos there. Whenever the Gemara or the Medrash talk about the water cried, the tree cried, waters and trees don't cry. It means the malach in charge of that water, the malach in charge of that tree, cried. And that's what Tosfos talks about, explains, at least the one explanation, Chulin Dav Zayin Amud Aleph, who's crying here. At any rate, the waters below began to cry, and their shout was, Anan be'inan lemeheva kama malka. What happened to me? I want to be with the water above. How did I end up here? What happened to me? A second ago, I was part of this huge glob of water, and we were all in front of God's throne, and suddenly, in a millisecond, I'm now down here in a lower place. I want to go back up and be close to God. And Anan be'inu lemeheva kama malka. The waters below started crying. I want to go up and be close to God. The Ribbono Shel Olam answered the water below and said, you're going to have a special zechus. On Sukkos, the waters that are gathered from below are going to be poured on the Mizbeach. And the second zechus you're going to have is salt, will be put on all karbonos in the Beis HaMikdash. And salt is salt water the water evaporates, you're left with salt. So that was another way that water goes onto the Mizbeach through the Karbonos. Our focus right now is on the Nisach HaMayim on Sukkos. So Ribbono Shel Olam said, yes, I understand why you're crying. I hear your cry. And I'm going to soothe your pain by taking water that is your water, the below water, and I'm going to tell the Jewish people to take that water and pour it on the Mizbeach on Sukkos. And with that, the water was calmed. So when we do the Nisach HaMayim on Sukkos, we pour it on the Mizbeach. Where does that water end up going back to? Our famous diagram, it's that diagram 3. But if you take a look at diagram 3, the Mizbeach, the water was poured on the Mizbeach, and the Mizbeach had two sapolim, it had two almost like nostrils at the top of it. One was used for the wine, one was used for the water. These nostrils were then connected into a pipe. We learned about the pipe that went down to the center of the earth. David dug that pipe, at least according to one shita. So what happened to this water? The water was drawn from the Shiloah in a celebration, brought into the Beis HaMikdash with the Tekiah, Trua Tekiah, was poured on the Mizbeach, went into this nostril, went back down to the center of the earth through the Sheetin pipe, So what has happened to this water? It was drawn from its source, poured on the Mizbeach, and sent back down to its original source. And this is done at the Simchas Beis HaShoeva, where everyone's singing about tshuva, a tekiah, true a tekiah, which reminds us of tshuva, and yet Rashi tells us it's simcha, and this is the Simchas Beis HaShoeva. What greater symbol is there to a human being than telling the human being you have an opportunity to go back to start? You have an opportunity to start all over again. You have an opportunity for the board to be completely erased. We're starting with a clean slate. The water is drawn. It goes onto the Mizbeach as an act of tshuva and goes right back to its original source. The water goes back to the center of the earth, the source of the world. And you too have the ability, if you're willing to sacrifice things, as which is what the Mizbeach is symbolic of, if you're willing to make the sacrifice, you too can go back to your original source and come back to a place where you thought you can never get to, given what you may have done in your life or what you may have not done in your life that you should have done. The Simchas Beis HaShoeva, post Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, you go to the Beis HaMikdash and you dance and sing in the Ezras Nashim, and the women are watching this in the balcony of the Ezras Nashim, and people are juggling fires, and it's a tremendous celebration, because we are now showing people that we can draw water. The water that cried when it was separated from the heaven, the water above, it cried. And now we're going to take that water and put it on the Mizbeach and console that water, because it too, by going on the Mizbeach, can serve Hashem. And it goes back to its original source. And what better simcha can a person have and sense that I can have a fresh start. I can start all over again and have a successful life without having the baggage behind me. And so this is the Simchas Beis HaShoeva. Ushaftem Mayim Besasson. Ushaftem Mayim Besasson is the introduction on a personal level. Through tshuva, we can now start all over again, fresh start, clean slate. And after Elul, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and all the work we did to do tshuva, we pour the water on the Mizbeach and we tell people, dance and sing, because your tshuva has given you a fresh start and a clean slate. Just like the water is going to go back to its original source. And so the tekiah, tshuva, and tekiah of Rosh Hashanah, which put us in a state of awe and fear to do tshuva, when we bring the water into the Beis HaMikdash through the Shah HaMayim, we blow the tekiah, tshuva, tekiah, and now we can hear that tekiah, tshuva, tekiah, not that fear, but the sense of joy that the tshuva can bring me to a place where I have a fresh start, a fresh year, a new year in which I can go into without the baggage that was behind me. This is also true for the Pasuk, Ushaftem Mayim Besasson, for the world that will be ushered in B'mehar V'yameinu. The same idea. We'll do tshuva, we'll be Megala the Yichud to the extent possible, and we'll usher in a whole new world with a fresh, clean slate, a world that we don't even understand is possible right now. But we'll usher in a new, beautiful world, and that's on the level of the world. Matzoi Shabbos, we say this pasuk Ushaftem Mayim Besasson Mimayne HaYeshua, and we remember that this is a pasuk in Yeshaya Perek Yud Beis pasuk Gimel. This is a pasuk that tells us we can usher in a new time with great blessing. And the tekiah, tshuva, tekiah that put me in awe on Rosh Hashanah is now a tekiah, tshuva, and tekiah of great joy, because I'm going to have a fresh start. So Matzoi Shabbos, after we have gone through the week and we've been uplifted by Shabbos, we're going to now have a fresh start for a new week. Will there be challenges? Certainly. Can we overcome the challenges? God gives us the ability to do that with His bracha, our effort in His bracha. And with this, a yid has a maleva malka. He's able to escort the queen out, and be prepared for the week that's coming. He's going to say his bori miori ha'esh, God of the Marishim rubbed two rocks together and invented fire. But you created Adam, you created his brain, you created those thoughts. And I'm now going into the week where I will be creating things and I will be devising plans and I will come up with new strategies, home, work, wherever. And please, God, bless my efforts as you blessed other Mauritians' efforts. And with that, I have a solid basis to go into my work week, knowing that it's my efforts and God's blessings. And I now go into the work week with Ushaftem Mayim Besasim. I can draw the water with joy. What water? The water that was poured on the Mizbeach for Nisach HaMayim that showed everyone that you can go back to your original source and start with a clean slate, no baggage behind you, and what a breath of fresh air to begin a new week with the idea of Ushaftem Mayim Besasim, and remember how water was poured on the Mizbeach and Sukkos in the Beis HaMikdash. The next week, we're going to just read quickly the last Sukkim in Perek Yud Beis, and then we're going to read quickly Perek Yud Gimel, a little introduction to Perek Yud Gimel, 13, Yudalud 14, Tesva 15, Tezayin 16, Yudzayin 17, until we get to 18. The next prokim we're going to probably learn quite quickly. They are Yeshayahu's Nevuah about the downfall of Bavel after Bavel destroys the Beis HaMikdash. They will fall to the Parasumadai, the Medes and the Persians. He prophesizes that. Then he prophesizes about the fall of Assyria. He prophesies about the fall of Moab. There's a lot of psukim in there that talk about the destruction of Assyria, the destruction of Moab, and the destruction of Bavel. And where it's necessary to highlight a pasuk, I will attempt to highlight the pasuk. Other than that, we will read the psukim with the English translation. When we get to Perek Yud Ches, Perek Yud Ches begins to describe the war of Gog and Magog, and has prophecies in it about the days of Mashiach. So we will go through Blineda next week, finish Yud Beis, and then begin the process of reading Yud Gimel, Yudalot, Tesvav, Tezayin, Yudzayin, highlighting that which is appropriate for us in the way we're learning Yeshaya, and then start looking at Perek Yud Ches, the Mochemes Gog Magog, and the days of Mashiach, Tzidkenu, and Erev Yomeinu.